Welcome to this lecture, although I don't really want to call it a lecture, for one. I think it's more of a presentation. I want to motivate why you'd be here, or at least you should think about why you're here, or ask yourself why you'd even sit in this lecture right now. And these are good questions to ask anytime you sit in a lecture, is why are you listening, and what's the point of whoever's talking to you, what are they trying to say to you? The reason I'm here is I think what McKelly's vision was for you as students, potentially, is to figure out where your research sits, put some context into where your research that you do might be applicable. Okay, so you're going to try to hopefully get a commercialization aspect once you leave the four lectures. At least figure out maybe where you might be going. Maybe you'll see a little connection to the economic impact that your research might have. Hopefully you're here because you're sort of interested in commercializing stuff. I think what's important was a question that came up in one of the meetings that McKelly had was the notion of patenting. And these are documents that usually are metrics in some sense for how well a company's doing or what a company's doing or what are the useful parts of research. Usually that you find them in patents. And so there's probably a dearth of patenting going on in such an institution. Like, there's not really a lot of patenting going on. But I think I want to highlight that it's a very important tool. We're going to discuss it right now. I think that's a big question that you might have. And it was a question of mine. It's like, if you want to go commercialization route, you want to think of patenting. So what is a patent? All these kinds of things. We're going to address them right now. And after that, I'm going to talk to you about the context of those patents. Hopefully, I'm going to answer these questions. Should you patent or publish? So let's go on with this next slide, which is basically, okay, and you're probably here because this is where you are. Apart from it being completely obvious, you can patent any kind of usefulness. But I want to distinguish between the word use and utility. I'll talk about this particular patent that I saw. It may come up, I'm not sure. But basically, it was utterly useless in the sense that, you wouldn't find any utility out of it. No one would actually go and do it. But yet you can still produce a document that says, this is what it does. And it has a use, but it doesn't have utility. I don't know if I'm making a good definition there, but what I'm looking for in terms of utility is that it may be broader in terms of its usefulness. Okay? So obviously you can't patent something that's useless. But there's a lot of useless patents out there. Does that make sense? When you look at them, you kind of go, wow, that's a patent. Or you think, geez, that's awfully, awfully narrow and maybe would never, ever get used. So I want to distinguish between what's coming next and those type of patents. So I want to make sure that, okay, you're here, you have an idea. Hopefully it's not like a Rube Goldberg invention where you wire up some string over some things, you cook some eggs in the morning, and you turn your light off, and it does that. And you can patent that kind of device because it's novel and unique, but it kind of serves a very small purpose. Might be an interesting house for you to live in, but do you know what I mean? It needs to be a little broader than that. And that's where these next slides will help you distinguish whether you should license something, hopefully, or if you think you can make a go of it. And when I say make a go of it, that's sort of where I find myself right now. Do you have an idea? It's probably not worth it if you just have one little idea. Is that really what we call a platform technology? Maybe, if your idea is huge, if your idea is very simple and has a lot of utility, that might be something you want to go out on. Okay, but in general, the first step of an inventor is usually the hallmark of an inventor is to have tons of patents and license them out, right? Because that means you can kind of do your invention. Keep inventing, keep thinking. So you're a student and you're reading your quantum textbook or you're in the lecture and you think, oh, that's a really cool idea. I get them all the time and maybe you do as well. And you can flesh that out and if it's useful to somebody, you license that out to them. Okay? And then it becomes an issue, a discussion with you and saying, well, how much is that worth? Do I just take the present value of the invention? Do I value the future of the invention? Do I want royalties? All these kinds of issues. Okay? You want to, if you're going to go that route where you license or you want to take it to a level where you maybe want to commercialize something, you got to think about who's going to care, right? And so there's three people that I think are relevant to students here. Because companies probably aren't going to be, I mean, there's a few out there, and I'll go over them, okay? But in general, you're going to be looking at venture capitalists, you're going to look at angel investors, and you're going to look at your government-funded institutions. And I just want to make sure, and we might be able to plow through these slides, but does everyone know what a venture capitalist is? Okay? Usually a representative of a fund that people put in. Either angels themselves will chuck money into a firm or a corporation, and then there's a couple of people who go, I have this much money, I chuck into this genre. Right, take, you know, and if I had Andrew Abishar here, because he's sort of our guy, you know, he could tell you a bit more about it. But basically, they represent money, okay, and they're trying to sort of hedge where to put that money in order to guarantee some return for their investors. Or, you know, in general, it's always about money, so that's usually what it's going to come down to. But you may get people that just sink money into it and say, you know, take my 100K, I don't care. Those are what we call usually, well, I group them into the angel investors. Angel investors are also people that are kind of like interested in your idea, maybe don't really care to gain a lot of money back, but they'll help you get started. They're in line with your vision, okay? And your vision at that point is probably not about maybe making money. It's maybe just like, I'm really happy I have this quantum computer. I want to build it. Can you help me build it? Somebody might come along and say, this is probably not going to make me any money, but I really like your idea, and those are kind of your angel investors, okay? You kind of have to seek them out. They're obviously not advertising, because then they'd be getting people calling them for their toilet and music kind of thing. You know, they'd be bothered. But in general, they can be people in an institution. Like, say, if you get the feeling that someone who's heading up a company has a vision underneath that underpins his, you can pull off their website. You can say, hey, that might be the guy I want to talk to. You know, you don't want to talk to, you know, the red tape to get to somebody like that, okay? And you never know, okay? But just ask. I think the best thing to do is you can ask me. I can direct you to people. I don't know. I'm not a bigwig. I don't have, like, Maple Leaf box tickets because I know people. I know a few people, and I guarantee that they'll be able to point you in the right direction. Okay, so those are the three people that I think are mainly, or the three things that you might be interested in with an idea here coming out of the institution. I want to briefly touch on three big terms that you should kind of put the context of what your idea is, isn't in. And the first is technology, and that's sort of like a capability. I just want to make sure we all understand what this means. It's not an invention per se. It might be an invention, but it's more of a method. It's more of a capability, okay? So it's probably an invention when it started, but after 20 years or after 30, 40 years, it becomes sort of a technology. So when you first did, say, lithography, and you first figured out how to etch something, you might have patented that etching process and so forth. You might have patented some design there. But after a while, people get to know, it gets exposed, it becomes sort of a technology, a capability, okay? And they can be skills. So people's skills, whatever you have, okay, those are sort of technologies. I want to just, you know, the invention is just something, okay? It doesn't, as you've seen, it doesn't need to be useful per se. It doesn't even have to have utility. But what we really want to talk about when we want to engage the people in the public sector or even people with money is an innovation, okay? And the innovation is really when you have something that can alter the behavior of the people, of the world you're living in, or the society you're growing up in. And that's when you see an innovation. That's what we call, or at least I like to call an innovation. So there's a difference between invention and innovation. And usually here I have an invention with utility. So yes, it's useful, of course, because it's an invention, but I'm trying to get to that point of it being a bit more useful than just useful. I wanted to throw this out, but I don't really know if we have time to go there. I wanted people to start thinking about, okay, where do you think quantum computing fits into innovation? You know, I would say, has it altered anything yet, quantum computing? In terms of people's behavior in society, has it hasn't, right? But there's been a hell of a lot of people who are now behaving into research, who are changing, you know, so there is an alteration there. It is an idea, there is something there. But it's not yet a utility, right? And the question is, will it become a utility? So you gotta have to, when you write a grant, when you write your algorithm, when you do whatever you do, you might want to think of the context of, okay, this is going to be a X kind of innovation, and I'm going to satisfy a very small part of that, but that's why you patent. And if you don't do that, they're not going to listen to you. Okay, so you've got to think of it like that. Quantum communication is definitely closer. You do see that it has some existing utility. So I know that my particular lab has a lot of interest in quantum communication, and we do like the satellite stuff. And really, that's a different realm. You know, there's a whole lot of technology there that can be invented. But the usefulness, the end goal, is to innovate to make the world secure. But along the way, a whole pile of inventions will come with adaptive optics and so forth and all kinds of things when you're looking to go to like satellite and stuff. And our group's doing that. Okay? But still, you do want to go back and say, well, why would I care shooting a beam up there and trying to track a satellite? Why do I really care? Is this really why I come to work this morning? Did I get up and go, hey, I define myself by this research? You know, to me, I kind of want to make sure I'm always grounded. And then you'll find that I always ask these kind of stupid questions, but it's because I want to really know why I should be listening and so forth. The details are great. But I just want to get you the feel for innovation. So I just went around and searched a bit. And so, again, this is 5 years out. But how many are out there on quantum key distribution when you go to the European database? You type in this word, quantum key distribution. I can give you these slides. You know, it's not a big deal. If you type those words in there, now this is going to be quantum and key and distribution. So it's not going to be the phrase quantum key distribution. But you're going to have these kinds of things in there. You're going to come up with 103 patents in the European database. That's 5 years ago, roughly. Okay, 81 with quantum computer in it. So, you know, you start to think, wow, are there 81 quantum computers out there already? And it's interesting because there are three quantum computers, same name, same title. You know, and we'll, you know, how is that possible? And what is it that differs one from another? And then you go to the key distribution one. There are 41 in the U.S., for example, 26 in the U.S. So just there again in one country now. Now we're not talking Europe. And even I believe Europe, the database I was searching was the world. So it has a little tag saying WO, which sort of says a world patent. So it searches China. It searches all the European stuff. Searches the U.S. So some of these are contained in others. Okay, and you but there are, they are definitely documents and their patents. For me, I'm an optics guy. I go down to I do the entangled photons, and this is particular because I have an invention. I have an idea on entangled photons, so I started searching how many entangled photon sources are there out there. You see there are 45 that sort of deal with entangled photons, 8 in if you have entangled photon source in the title, you know, and so forth. You have 25 and 2 in the US. But what I'd like to highlight there is that this is a niche patent. This is a very niche patent, entangled photon source. Nobody else would care about it. And yet there are lots out there. So I think it's encouraging, right? It's discouraging in the sense that, damn, they've already got one out there. But it's encouraging in the sense that, okay, there are these little details are out there, okay? And then you might be surprised at who's got these. And it might just, you know, say, hey, you know, this might be something I could do. Okay, I would submit that both this quantum computation and communication have yet to become an innovation. So why? We can talk about that. I don't really want to get into that discussion, but I definitely think you should ask yourself that before, you know, why is it not yet there? Okay. So this slide here. If you think it's going to be, hopefully you're here because you think it's going to be, then I suggest patenting as a viable option. And I think we're all here for that reason, so I'm not going to spend too much time on that slide. Of course, those inventors want to know that. We've already went through that. These are four things. This is coming through these silly little business classes that I've taken. Okay, no, they're not silly, but I kind of think they're silly. At least when I got to the first one, I was like, whoa, this is, I'm going to spend a whole day listening to these guys. And then I realized that, wait a minute, the reason they're teaching you this is because this has come down from mountains of experience. And it isn't obvious what to do. Even though it may seem to for scientists. You guys are pretty logical, right? You'd be like, man, why did that company do that? But what I've realized is that it's always in hindsight. What you want to do is look at four basic things when you want to put your idea into context. Okay? You have to have what's called a value proposition. You want to have sort of a mission statement. This is kind of getting there where I'm not sure if it's wishy-washy or not. You want to figure out what strategy you might want to pursue with your product or with your idea, and you want to figure out what the risks are. Now, I know that you're going to tune out because you don't have a product, so you don't have a mission statement, you don't even have a company, you don't know what your strategy is, you don't have all this stuff, but it should always be in the back of your mind when you're putting down a grant application, okay? Because I would actually say that you as a person are also an entity, and you should have these kinds of things for yourself, okay? You have to think of the customer, the employee, the partner, and the supplier. And those are pretty obvious, but they all have different value propositions. So as a company or as a person who's going to do something with a technological idea, you've got to figure out, okay, what value am I bringing to my customer? What value am I bringing to my employees? So forth, okay? Now, I know we don't have companies, so I'm just going to let this one slide. But you should think of the value proposition for your idea. Like, you know, what am I selling? What am I, why am I trying to get this thing out there? Who's going to buy it? How much money is it? So forth. Okay, your mission statement. I put down University of Waterloo. I put down Kevin Resch. You can put your name down. You know, what is your mission? You know, why do you get up in the morning and why do you attend class? You know, what are you doing your research for? You know, why are you working on satellite QKD? These are things that the business people want to know as well. They want to know what you're about. They want to know what your idea might be about. They want to know if it's a platform thing. They want to know what your mission statement might be. You figure out what you want out of your research. Put your research into context. And that often, in terms of research, that often turns into like, okay, I want to have this visibility for my entangled photon source, or I want to, I don't know what it would be for a theorist, but experimental people like myself, it's easy to get quantitative, okay? But you need to have that. If you don't write a grant, you don't say, this is my exit, this is my result, this is my vision, you won't get your money. I'll whip through the pest analysis. Whenever I took these business courses, I never found this kind of stuff relevant because it's not relevant to my research. You know, political, economic, social, technical. But I would submit to you that it is, a little bit. So you should think of all these kinds of things of where your invention or idea is going to sit. There are things called industry analysis where you want to say, and this is maybe a little more important. If you have something, you might think that, okay, is it easy for someone to make? In my personal experience, I have this idea. It's easy for someone else to make. You know, so that's bad, okay? There's only one person that makes it. And that's bad. Right? So there's bargaining power on your suppliers, bargaining power of your customers. So if I wanted to go with my idea that I have, which I'll explain to you maybe next time, I have to think of these kinds of things. Okay? And you know, and you as an entrepreneur, if they're out there, should think of these kinds of things. Is your idea really something that you want to license or make a go of? Right? These are the two things that an entrepreneur, I'm trying to tie this back. This is not a resume padding type of thing, right? Just go briefly over strategy stuff. They'll want to know this as well. And this is probably the last big term is, what are you going to do with your idea? You know, are you going to, is it like a cheaper mousetrap or better mousetrap? And does that mean that you're going to pursue that kind of thing? Or are you going to be like different? I would submit that quantum is probably in these last two, niche and different, where you offer different features. But your markets are totally different, right? Your market doesn't exist for quantum computers. So you have to create that. It's all kinds of interesting things like that. But you have to really think of it. Okay, these are the four terms, so let's just go over them. And again, I just want to make sure you know we should care, because it will help you decide why you're getting up in the morning and coming here. Okay, and should help you decide where your research is going. So even if you're not going to be an entrepreneur, if you're going to be an academic professor, I don't know, this should really help guide your research. So even as a professor, you know, you're selling something. Everybody's selling something every time you go up and talk or whatever. You got to figure that out. So, I mean, anyone who's maybe interested in the academic side, that's what you should be thinking of, these kinds of contexts of where your research is going, okay? And I think McKelly wanted me to make sure that this got out to you, not only in the context of being an entrepreneur, but in general, okay? Okay, so let's review that. Those are the four things that I think in 10 minutes, of all the pain and suffering I went through with business courses, those are really the things that people want to know about, and there's all kinds of details that business people can throw slides at you and so forth, but those are really the things you want to think about. Okay, and then, of course, the last one I wanted to touch base on, and we'll get into this in the next lecture, and I promise it will be much more poignant for you in the following lecture, but I want to talk about what's called sustaining and disruptive innovation. Okay, and I need you to know this, because this is really the most important topic or point I've taken away from business courses, is to identify whether the research you're doing has the potential to be a disruptive innovation. And if it's disruptive, that means people will sink money into your idea. And so we'll go over what disruptive is. Okay? The slide I just have here is Sustaining innovation is when you just keep making things better. And the disruptive innovation is when you really change how people behave. Okay? So instead of improving on something that you currently have, so like you've got 128-bit encryption, you go to 256-bit encryption, you go to whatever, you can kind of see where people are thinking quantum encryption or this new type of, I guess, one-time pad encryption. It's not new, but the practicality of it might be a disruptive innovation. So if you can make that practical, it now becomes it will make everybody else obsolete, all these algorithm guys and so forth who work on elliptic curve and whatever. Maybe that's not going to be a big care if you've got one-time pad and it becomes useful and practical. So I want to make sure, so what I'll do is I'll talk about disruptive and sustaining next time, and I'll also talk about me as a person who went through some funding avenues to get money for my idea. So for those of you who have ideas, I will discuss my choices that I made, and maybe that'll help you figure out if you want to pursue those choices. I will just say the following thing, so that the end is that I ran into some people who I know who have patented. And just to get your glands a little bit wet, is that even if you don't do anything with your patent, and Catherine was going over this a couple of weeks ago in our group meeting, somebody might buy your patent, right? You can make a buck on your patent. And I know people in this building were offered, $5,000 just to turn their little, publication into a patent. And bye-bye. There's 5K right there, right? So don't be afraid to couch it in the language of usefulness, because you can maybe even make your 5K. That's essentially what you do, is you license it away to someone who may choose to make use of it. But I'll just say that there are, that's a way to make a buck, right? It's not about, do I need to do all this stuff? That's maybe where the entrepreneurs lie. It isn't necessarily a resume padding thing, but you can also just sell it, right? And it can be useful to you, or it can in that manner.